Good evening, everybody. Welcome to All About Guitar. We have a great show for you, and I think it's a very important one. Joining us again, returning, is Dr. David Allan. He was on several months ago, and we talked about hand injuries and repetitive stress injuries is the technical term, and the fact that a lot of musicians, especially musicians my age that have been playing for a long time, almost all of them are having issues with their hands or arms or wrists. And the most common one everybody knows about is carpal tunnel, but there are several other types of injuries that happen from doing repetitive, over practicing, or doing something, injuring yourself in practicing or playing. And so we talked a little bit about the basics of it on the last show, and the type of things, a little bit about preventive, how to take care of yourself so that you don't get those. But now we're going to go a little more into detail. And we're going to talk a little more about his new program that he has developed called Musicianship Wellness Program, which is specifically for musicians. And tonight we're going to talk about guitar-related injuries and the types of therapies that can be done. And also, first of all, welcome to the show, Dr. David. It's great to have you here.
Yeah, it's great to be here, Jeff. Thank you for having me.
And I also want to mention, he is a guitar player, and he's going to be playing guitar tonight. Also, we're videoing what he's talking about tonight, and that will be up on YouTube, and we'll put the link up, so you'll actually be able to see. Because we're going to talk about one of the things that Dr. Allan stresses that can kind of help, is like the root of solving a lot of the issues, and that is posture. And, how your body, it's to get your body in a natural relaxed position. And we have several different things that this is a cool one, so you're gonna really like this. But anyway, briefly explain a little bit Musicianship Wellness, your program, and what we were talking about kind of from the last show about posture and position. There's several things, and we'll go into more detail, but I want to just kind of set it up a little bit.
Well, I started Rocketship Wellness many, many years ago, and it just made sense to create a separate program for the artists, the musicians. And I have recently put together musicianshipwellness.com, and also I have artistshipwellness.com. So I think it's a great information to get my fellow brother and sister musicians to soar to their potential.
Okay, now you had mentioned before, we had discussed on the other show, posture, proper, putting the body in a naturally relaxed position. And there was two things. First of all, what that position was. And we talked a little bit about the embodied chair, which I actually used. And I went down to his office a couple of times and we tried out all this stuff. And then the other thing was the fact that correct posture, the most natural state for the human body is to be, it's constantly in motion. I want you to elaborate more on that, because that's important.
Well, I love talking about posture, because posture means position, but really, in real life, life is movement. So you're constantly in motion.
Mm-hmm.
And so if we can embrace that more and really understand the meaning behind having a better posture and really feeling more comfortable when we do things, then that's really the key. It's not a set of rules that's going to tell somebody that you should do this and you should do that. I think what's most important is that you want to try to do everything you could possibly do with the least amount of effort. That way you have more power.
Okay, so how would you define posture? Because I think we were talking a little bit before the show, and when, as a guitarist growing up and being in classes, and it was like you need to sit this way and be this way. It was kind of a rigid thing. Whereas you talk about it more as an adapting and a moving type of thing. Can you elaborate a little more on that? Because I think we have to go beyond the stereotype of what posture is, so to speak, as opposed to, a relaxed position of the body and the flexibility. It's moving, it's constant.
Well, posture works really well when we want to analyze things for a certain moment.
Right.
And that's really what it should be used for, because we just don't want to hold a position unless you got a gig in Buckingham Palace, and then you probably have to stand rigid and you have to be as as stiff as possible. But you don't want to be stiff. You want to be able to be floating and relaxed as possible. And when I say floating, we're sitting right now. I'm sitting on my sits bones on the chair. I'm sitting up in a way where I can flow back and forth with my pelvis this way. I could flow back and forth side to side. I can come down. I could come up. And so these are the awareness to positions and how they really affect our playing physically and every part of our being, and also how our positions really really affect our performance. Because I'm looking, besides just getting people to play with more relaxed and with more ease, I want them to embody the holistic approach to what we're talking about, because your posture is your presence, and your presence, if you could have a powerful presence, you have the chance to live more to your potential. And I constantly see all these musicians that are not really in touch with this component, and there's many great players. I just look over and over again, and they're not paying attention to their posture at all. And it's nothing to knock anybody's position, but for them to understand that if they can embrace the idea of having different postures, especially more of a balanced posture, they're going to have a better career, they're going to have less injuries, and they're going to, I think, they could live more up to their potential as players, as well as people that want to have a quality life all the way through.
Well, one of the things that we that you discuss is one of the principles of the wellness program is that there's no right or wrong posture or good or bad posture.
That's just really bringing in the idea that posture means position, and we don't want to assume any set position. And when we're talking about posture, lots of times we think of absolutes, where you have a good posture, which this is good and this is bad. And neither one is good or bad. Each position has a certain amount of stress and strain against gravity, and that stress and strain affects us. It affects our health, either positively or negatively. And especially over a long period of time, if I'm getting in front of a post-secondary education, I want to make sure these aspiring musicians can really have more of an education and understanding that posture, yes, posture's position, and we could take a look and analyze posture to a certain part, but that doesn't make you a better player. That doesn't make you feel better. It's really important to understand that you want to embrace a balanced posture, and that is kind of like knowing that our body's in movement, our body's in motion. Even when we're sitting here, it takes me an effort to stay upright in the chair, otherwise I would fall over. So I'm maintaining a certain certain awareness to my position in space, and it can be in all sorts of ways.
So, and when you play, you're moving all the time.
And when I'm playing, I was a guitar player starting at 12, and I started playing again, and I realized that I have all these habits for 50 years of, this is how I would basically play. I'd kind of hunch over, and I'd look at the fingerboard, and there's nothing wrong with that, but I know that there's greater potential if you're more balanced and you're more present, especially if you're performing, if you're more up this way. So I'm really taking a very close look at how I'm playing now, and all the guidelines I want to give people to take a look at and to evaluate and try it out and see how one posture feels compared to another.
Well, one thing I do want, and before we get into more specific these principles or what we're talking about right now, I want you to explain something, which is kind of your overall philosophy, if I'm correct. And you say in your notes that you sent me, the key to better performance is awareness and mindfulness, along with applying musicianship wellness principles. Can you explain that, what that means?
Well, if you're just coming to a college to learn how to play guitar, there's probably awareness to just playing the guitar, not necessarily about anything else. So I think in order to be a better performer, you want to first understand what it is you want to take a closer look at, and that's mm-hmm. where the awareness comes in. So you want to have awareness. Awareness is being in a place where you sense yourself. How do you feel? How do you feel compared from one position to the next? How does this posture feel? How does this posture feel? Does this feel better? Does this feel worse? And so the mindfulness is the ability for us as human beings, we have the consciousness to change. We don't have to stay in any position. We can create and we can do all kinds of things. So I think it first starts off with you want to have an awareness of yourself.
Mm-hmm.
And the principles I'm using have been used for many years in the Alexander technique,
mm-hmm.
which is one technique I've looked closely at in the last couple of years, because they kind of take a look at, they're focusing more on the artist, the musician, and especially the actor. And so why would you want to learn this? You want to learn it because having more of an awareness of yourself gives you the power to be able to be in any to change your position if necessary, and understand that one position, how you hold yourself, is going to represent an emotion. So if you're playing like this all the time, hunched over, you know that has an emotion. And so once again, nothing wrong with playing. But wouldn't it be nice for the young up-and-coming artists to recognize that all these positions really convey a feeling, convey an emotion, and let them have the awareness to discover all these positions and have the power to stay more balanced, because mm-hmm. as you get older, you're in your 20s and you're just playing and you're not even thinking about your health and you're doing all this repetitive stuff. And it catches up with you.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's the thing. Like, if you're huddled over, like when you're practicing mm-hmm. and you're learning a part, you're kind of introverted. So your music is going inward.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas when you're performing, you're looking up and you're out and you're projecting. So you play up, aware, and more, so you're projecting out. Right?
Okay, but when you're, let's say you're in a studio and you're all by yourself and you want to crunch this part, if you have more of a relaxed, upright power posture, that conveys a certain sound in your instrument. So
right.
you know, if you want to have the most power, you want to be the most balanced you can.
Yes, yes, and also too, that relaxed attitude of, or just in general to be relaxed when you're playing. I learned it from being in sessions for long hours. You need to do something, you need to be relaxed, or you're going to get sore, or you're going to have back problems or hand problems or whatever it's going to be. You've got to be relaxed, or else you won't be able to play for that. Because that's if you're playing 6 or 9 hours, you know, 3 3-hour sessions, which would be normal for in playing sessions, you would go like, you know, each session was like a 3 hour. That's a long time, and you need to be able to be relaxed enough so you can endure it. Without, if you're tightening up or you're hunching over, you're going to mm-hmm. get your back sore or something else is going to happen.
And this is just one part of what I consider musicianship wellness, because I'm thinking globally, I'm thinking holistically. What about what you're thinking about every day? You know, the little things that we do each day will define our success or our failures later in life. How are you, how's your nutrition? What are you feeding yourself?
Mm-hmm.
And so when you stop in for a fast food meal, you don't all of a sudden have a heart attack. But people got to realize that if it's all you're eating is fast food stuff, it's not in your best interest.
Mm-hmm. It's a whole holistic approach.
That once again, you want to have awareness and then use your mind to make better choices and work with the habits and get better habits going, so you can live to your potential as a player, as a performer, and as a human being. Wanting to live a quality life.
Now, you had just mentioned a little bit on it, but I want you to explain a little further. One of the principles: every posture, position, and activity poses poses a defined amount of strain or force load on the body.
That's what I think of posture, whether it's not good or bad. It's that whatever position you're in creates a certain amount of stress and strain. So that way, there's no good or bad posture. Mm-hmm. Now we could take a look at a position and say, well, you know, this is good and that's bad. I just prefer not, because a lot of people get into this name calling and you talk about this is bad, and people realize that they have all these bad postures. And the word bad, it should be reserved for something like, you know, like a guy running after you with a knife. That's bad. To have a certain posture isn't bad. Maybe it's not the most relaxed posture. Maybe it's not the posture that is going to be good for you to maintain all the time because of the imbalances. So there's a certain amount of stress and strain that goes on in every position in life, and that's what I like to think about when I think about posture. And this whole idea of movement, I call it natural posture.
Mm-hmm.
So that's my way of.
Now, you had showed me on the other show, you showed me when I went down to your office, how your body moves. And you had said that the natural relaxed position of the body is like your hands are out, like ready to embrace, kind of out. And I'm trying to, you're showing it on the video. And that the breathing, your chest goes down and kind of, and then when you breathe up, it opens up. And at the same time, your neck straightens out.
Mm-hmm.
And all of that constant motion, everything's moving. It's like a very, it's not just one thing. It's not you inhaling, exhaling. It's not just your chest, but your whole body is moving to the breath so that it's constantly moving. Now, in that, okay, I understand that standing up and seeing, and also too, and being in the in-body chair, which props your, helps support your hands in that position.
Mm-hmm.
But now let's talk about specifically, you're sitting down right now with the guitar,
mm-hmm.
and how does that motion, that constant motion, I mean, yes, the breathing's part of it, but if you can, it's hard to, it's, what I'm asking is how would, if you can show us that, how would you, what would be a natural movement, constant motion while you're playing? He's lifting the guitar up and down like a rock and roll Chuck Berry type of thing.
Well, that's more of an extreme, and that happens all the time in performing.
Yeah.
But, you know, let's say you're playing a classical piece and you want to be still, or you're in session, you got a mic right at the guitar. Well, you really can't move around too much, really, realistically. But it's really your awareness to your position and having yourself kind of having a sense of the parts of the body that they kind of float a little bit. Like, let's say for your shoulders, they don't have to hang, and you don't have any awareness there. Right now, from this position, and it's very subtle, you're not going to see this on the film, but right now, I'm just from this position to this position is different. So as I come up a little bit more, you know, and then
you're breathing, right? So you're moving up and down a little bit in your chest and your back.
That what you're referring to is kind of an exercise to get people aware and to work with their habits, because they're not usually thinking about anything except playing. But believe it or not, you are sitting, you are breathing, our nervous system allows us to multitask and focus in for playing, focus in on playing, and not have to deal with all these other things that go on. So you can have this awareness, and it's almost like we could talk, I'd say the things that you're trying to have me explain right now is very subtle. We could talk about general positions might be better. So when I'm holding the guitar here, you know, we have the position of straight up and down, where do we want to put the guitar, and how does that feel?
Yeah, he's using a strap right now, so the guitar is up on his chest. It would be higher than like a normal rock and roll position. He's not leaning it on his knee. With the strap, it's up almost like a close to like classical guitar positioning. But he was talking about moving, that whether you have the neck down straighter or up towards your shoulder. which is more like classical guitar. So he's moving around.
Yeah, and then the strap allows me to keep this height that I've chosen that feels comfortable for me. And then we have this tilting up and down. And then we also consider, I think, a real important part of holding the guitar is, where is the guitar going to be in terms of going forward and back, so where it angles here. So if we have the guitar, lots of times you'll sit with the guitar this way up against your chest, and you could play this way, but it puts your arm in a tougher position. And then if you want to look at your fingers, which a lot of us want to, we'll look at the key, at the fretboard, and so you have to strain your neck. So if you bring the guitar over here, that just makes it
straining as much. You know, the reason I'm asking this is, one, regardless if you are a vocalist or a wind or horn player, breath is important. Breathing is important because it affects the phrasing. You know, the way you phrase it's the same as if you were breathing, as if you were singing it. So when you run a line, if you watch some of a really good classical player or a good jazz player, he's actually breathing to the phrase line. So he'll take a breath.
I think most importantly is you want to keep your breath flowing free. There's a tendency to kind of hold our breath if we're working through a difficult passage. And that, once again, creates more stress and strain. Once again, there's nothing wrong. There's nothing wrong about holding your breath and playing a little bit. But once again, all these principles should be explored. And the whole idea is to really have somebody play with the least amount of effort. Once again, if you're going to have more power, less chance of injury, longer life, longer quality life, and better performance. So it's just something that could be added to any instrument and to any program.
Okay. Now, you also mentioned, one of the principles you mentioned is, let the music and the guitar come to you.
Okay. Lots of times we go to the guitar, or we go to the instrument, and mainly what I'm describing is that we have this instrument stuck on our chest, this guitar, so there's a tendency for us to come to it, and so we're usually folding forward, so we're coming to the guitar, where, you know, the instrument is really a part of us, and if we bring the instrument to us, we create some space in there, and we can, it's just going to be more powerful. And once again, let's have the students and the people that are interested in exploring these principles and see how they feel. Once again, I don't want to be in a position to dictate that these are the rules, these are absolutes, this is right and this is wrong, this is good posture, that's bad posture, this is incorrect, this is correct. I know from experience for so many years what is more balanced, and let me see how I can get the students and the musicians that are interested in changing, which is hard,
making changes. Well, no, I mean, I look at even the way I'm approaching and questioning you. I'm so used to being, this procedure, posture, technique. You know, how you position the guitar. We were indoctrinated with that. You have to do it this way. It's got to be like this. You got to play like that. So even it's very difficult for me to let go of that because I was brought up that way.
Absolutely, it's sacrilegious. I mean, to start, like, if you got a pro player that's in their posture, if you look at them, go, well, that to me doesn't look like good posture. But they're playing great, and they don't have any aches and pains. I can't necessarily help that person. Mm-hmm. I'm going to help people that want to improve themselves globally, holistically.
Now, it was interesting. I just want to mention that when I was at when I went to Dr. Allen's office, I brought my electric guitar down. He asked me to bring a guitar down so we could, experiment a little bit with posture and stuff. And it's very cool what you have there. You have a video set up where the guy, whoever comes in, can come in and look and see what their posture is, and then they can discuss what they're doing and how they're doing it. Because again, there is no right or wrong, but you were showing. It was interesting because when I was standing up with the guitar, I'd lean back. And you asked me about that, like, why are you leaning back? And I think it's from maybe not this guitar, but a lot, some of my guitars are pretty heavy, and you just lean back to kind of counter the weight.
That happens with, it's one of my habits. So the looking in a mirror, and you know, today we have our iPhones and our iPads or whatever, so you can set up your phone and put it like you're going to take a selfie, and you can put it up in front of you and see what you look like. I like to look from the side as well. There's a lot of things you can learn from looking at the side. So most musicians, most people don't really see what they look like, and that could be a very important ingredient in a classroom situation to help people become more mindful with the awareness. If you don't know what you look like, then how could you have awareness?
Yeah.
So you wanna have that awareness and see how you can make changes to improve yourself.
Now, I'm taking a picture of him right now because I want to describe something. He's been sitting right now through the whole interview. We've been talking almost a half an hour. He's sitting on the edge of the chair. He's sitting up straight. His shoulders back a little bit, except when he's grabbing the neck or something. But for the most part, his shoulders are back, not hunched over. And he's pretty much standing pretty straight, which is, I know the sitting on the edge of the chair, his position as a guitar player, that's one of the things I was taught in the classical guitar, is that type of position where you sit on the edge of the chair. He's not sitting all the way back with the backrest against his back. He's sitting supporting himself. And that's it, you know, it's interesting because it's, you know, there is a reason, I mean, not to throw out all of the rules that they gave us from before, but there was actually, and we were talking about this too, in classical guitar, the way the guitar is positioned, the way they tell you to do it, maximizes the vibration front. You're not hindering the top of the guitar, and it less stressful way to hit your hand on the fingerboard, and also your hand from picking. It allows you to play. It actually is a relaxed position for that type of playing. Now, different for blues playing, rock playing, where you're bending. The guitar
and there's nothing wrong with playing the guitar back here, but you have to recognize that this will have a certain effect on the music. It's going to sound different. I mean, it's going to sound all laid back.
Yeah, he's leaning back now on the chair.
It feels good to really rest on something, because when you're up here like this, there's less support, so you have to be the support mechanism. And I just want to catch what you said. You said he's mainly kind of sitting up straight. But once again, the straight, I'm not sitting up straight. I appear that I have a balanced, upright posture, but part of my method is called don't stand up straight. Once again, to address that posture issue, good posture, bad posture, incorrect posture, correct posture, there's just positions. There's just positions and moments, and during those moments, there's a certain amount of stress and strain that goes on.
Right, well, I mean, the way you're sitting is the weight is going to your hips,
yeah,
in an even way. It's not like you're not leaning,
mm-hmm.
You're not hunching over, which changes the center of the weight. The way you're sitting, if I'm correct, where you're roughly where your belly button is the center of gravity or the.
Yeah, for an example, as I lean forward here, my pelvis is rocking forward.
All right, I'm trying to take pictures. This is a little hard to describe, but okay.
So I'm rocking forward. So my butt is sticking out more. I'm rocking forward. And then now I'm rolling it back the other way. So I have, in this position, I have this range of motion forward and then back. Now, so what would be more balanced would be probably somewhere about in between there. So if I really play with the extremes of going forward and back, I could get a sense of, oh, that's about center. But once again, even center, I'm not holding. We're not holding.
Right. Even in that center position, you're moving forward and back slightly.
I can. I am. I don't think we ever really sit still. We may think we're sitting still, but there's some movement unless you're fully supported by a couch and you're watching TV or whatever. And that's more, you're more inclined to be more locked into a position. But when you're playing, this gives you a chance to have more presence. It's, you know, I was in a company once where I had to make a lot of phone calls.
Mm-hmm.
And they said, they really encouraged me to stand up when I made my calls. Because when you're standing up, even though the person didn't see you, your tone changes. And the energy is completely different. Because I was trying to sell something. So mm-hmm. I didn't want to sell something while sitting back in a chair. It's like, hey, would you want to buy some vitamins from me? And they're really good. And I would sit forward. Mm-hmm. I would stand up. And that way I'd really have more power.
Yeah, it's what I'm trying to do is talking with you. It's not apparent that you're moving. It doesn't look like you're moving. And I'm trying to see it because that whole breathing thing. Because we talked about that.
I hope I'm moving because there's breath going in, yeah. And you know, in that breath, those ribs expand. It's very subtle, and the beauty with the Alexander technique, because I've learned from all these different methods, is when you're playing, the Alexander teacher will just stand behind you and kind of just guide you, and so you can change your position a little bit and see how that little change feels.
Now, I'm seeing you breathe. Yeah, we want to show this piece here. He has a little device that he puts on his guitar. You go ahead and describe this. I don't know how to describe it, but it actually helps you set the guitar in a more natural position.
It's just
position.
A piece of PVC pipe, and I went to one of my mentors was an Alexander teacher. His name is Ethan Kind, and ethankind.com. I don't mind giving him a plug because he's brilliant because he's been focusing on musicians, and he's an Alexander teacher. And I went to visit him in Albuquerque for a quick 5-hour lesson. So he had one of these. And he says, I have an extra one. If you want it, I'll sell it to you. So what this does is it has a Velcro there, and I have Velcro on my guitar.
Mm-hmm.
This is such a beautiful guitar. I almost cringed when I put on the Velcro, but he said that you could take it off and it won't harm the finish. So but I'm glad I'm able to do it anyway. So we take this device here, and we could throw it on here. And I would like to see how we could make it more fashionable, because it is what it is.
But if you can make that out of wood, it'll look just like the guitar. That's my
that would be great.
That's my take on
that
it.
That would be great. So now, there I could use this. I don't have to prop up my leg. If I prop up my leg, once again, nothing wrong with propping up your leg, but it changes the balance in the pelvis. So here I can maintain my pelvis level, and then I'm in a position, and I have the strap. I don't even need the strap when I'm using this device. I don't know what we want to call it, but
I don't know what.
Well, that's all it is a prop to bring the guitar into a position. So you could really. You can use anything as long as you Velcro in.
It's very comfortable. I tried this guitar. This is his Taylor Classical, and at his office, I tried it, and it's very it was easy to play, very comfortable, and worked really well. And now, also too, I have a question because I see. Okay, we talked about your breathing and you're moving your hands.
Mm-hmm.
One of the things that, now you're kind of not, you're not squirming, but you're moving. What do you do about your legs, especially your knees? Because one of the things that happens with me, and maybe it's because I'm getting older, but when you sit down for a long time and your feet and your legs are in a static position, they get sore. When you get up, it's kind of hard to get up. How would you move, what's the natural way, if I can say it that way, to have movement in your legs, because it doesn't look like you have that much opportunity to move around.
Well, that's correct. There's not much opportunity, and so you'll find that even in the most comfortable position, we were talking about the body chair, which is the supreme comfortable position for the entire body, after about 20 minutes, you start to get stiff. So that tells you that if you're in a sitting for more than 20 minutes, it's time to get up.
Oh, okay.
Take a little break. Because we've spent so many years away from what's really natural. The reason why I call it natural is because we look at little kids. We don't have to tell the little kids how to stand and sit. I mean, they don't stand and sit very much. They're moving. They're constantly exploring, and that I think is really the way the we were meant to be, and meant to be healthy within our physical body. But we're sitting and sitting all day long. We're texting. We're driving, and it just gets us farther and farther away of what's natural.
Yeah, no, I've noticed too. Walking is one way to relax my. If I do that, I circulate like in the morning. If I'm achy or sore, the joints are sore, I just walk around.
Walking is great, and part of my course is not only showing people how to play the guitar, but talk about sitting, talk about standing, and the basic things that we do every day, because our habits, if we can be more relaxed doing everything, that's going to transfer over to us as players and professional musicians.
Yeah, it goes beyond just playing. It's mm-hmm. just your whole lifestyle in that's that right. sense. Now, I wanted to also mention now there this is another one of the principles, is what we think about is what we bring about. Because now we're getting into some interesting, some heavy
stuff. Well, I have a lot of fun with teaching my method, and I use my rocket ship.
Okay.
My rocket ship is an example of this teaching model. And in the rocket ship, you have parts of the rocket ship that we could kind of take a look at. We have the rocket ship body, and we've been talking about the body the entire time.
Mm-hmm.
But then we have a rocket ship mind, and the rocket ship mind is our steering mechanism, where our body goes in life.
Mm-hmm.
And if we want to have more powerful people, more powerful players, then we want to be thinking more powerfully and use our mind to guide us. And the mind is probably the most important component of everything, because mm-hmm. the mind controls what we do, and it controls our puppet, our body, which I call the puppet. You know,
mm-hmm.
Our body's just like a puppet. It does what we want it to do.
Yeah, like so, you mentioned too that for things to change, you have to change. For things to get better, you have to get better.
Oh, this is a quote. I'd like to say I made it up. But one of my great mentors in personal development is Jim Rohn, R-O-H-N.
Mm-hmm.
And that's one of Jim's lines. If you think you're going to make a change and if you want to do something different and not change, then you're, that's a Thomas Edison quote. If you do the same thing over and over and over again and think you're going to get a change, then you're not in reality. So if you want to get better, you have to get better, and to get better, you have to change to get better, and you want to be the change. And in life, you want to take an evaluation of yourself, your awareness, use your mind to grow, to get better, and that growth is movement itself.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Well, you also say take control and responsibility for your actions. So it's a very proactive type of experience.
That's what I hope wellness is about, because I'm not looking to fix anybody. I'm looking to help them. I have some very powerful skills over the years that I've learned to help people, but most importantly, I want to educate them so I could kick them out of the office and get them feeling better and have them take responsibility for themselves, because I'm not walking around and thinking for these people. They have to think for themselves, and they have to make the changes. And it's not easy to change, but if you recognize all this, and you take things step by step, anybody can be better at any age.
Yeah.
Doing anything.
Yeah, well, we spent so many years, like if you do something a certain way, like staying in a fixed position or something, you have to unlearn that.
Mm-hmm.
And that's, you know, you've taken a lot of years to learn that. It's going to take a few to unlearn it.
You were talking about my feet as I'm sitting here. And, you know, the feet's not really that much of a problem when I'm sitting. It's more, there's more pressure on my butt. So if I'm more of an upright posture, I have that ability to freely move my pelvis.
You're moving
that
your,
helps.
You're moving your pelvis, and I think the main weight is on your pelvis.
Sure.
I've noticed that, like, sometimes I don't understand what I'm doing, but when I'm sitting, sometimes I'm putting pressure to the floor. So I'm like, there's stress. My legs, like if I'm For example, it's like if I'm pushing down on my legs or my feet, like to get up, but I'm not getting up, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
So if after a certain amount of time, I'll feel stress in my, or strain in my shin and calf, like I'm pushing down. And I don't know how, why, is it just because, like right now I'm sitting in a chair where I'm sitting in the back and it's tilting up. Is that why, or is
sure
it?
when you have a strain and you're aware enough to appreciate and understand that strain, there's too much stress going into that area. So that's all you have to do is you want to take that pressure and you want to distribute it more through the body. That's the embodied chair. So if you're feeling more stressed in your feet, then you could push against your foot and feel that wave of energy come all the way up through the body, and that will help disperse the stagnation that's occurring to a certain point. Once again, probably your best bet is to take a break, get up and
walk around.
Yeah.
But I've noticed that, I don't know if, it has to be a tension, like if, for example, the same principle as me clenching, like for example, I'm clenching my hand sometimes, not necessarily playing, but like, if I'm working at the computer or writing something, you know, you're unconsciously clenching.
Yeah, it's like when you're sitting in the dentist chair, I know I have to be relaxed, but I just all of a sudden tighten up and I have to keep reminding myself to relax. And I think you have to do that, some more than others. Most of us have a tendency of tightening up and stressing out more than they need to. So if you're cutting something with a knife, you could use the weight of the knife to push through the material you're cutting versus to power through it. So it's awareness and really getting a sense of what you're doing and how it feels.
Well, I'm noticing, like for example, with writing, that I'm applying pressure. You know, if you picture yourself writing with a pencil or a pen, okay, you have your three fingers, but I'm finding myself pushing in when I don't need to push. I don't need to apply pressure.
Big habits. Those are big habits.
Yeah. So I'm noticing that because
you're left-handed.
Right.
I'm left-handed also. And that creates even more of a problem because, not a problem, but there's more challenges because in the writing world, we have to push forward. We have to push we have to push across the page. Whereas if you're a right-handed person, you kind of just pull. It flows much better. So lots of times left-handed people will turn the page or bring the hand around.
Yeah, they kind of curl around.
So this is, once again, all this are very important awareness type of activities that you could take a look at. And you can improve as long as you can get in touch with your feelings and understand how you can make a change to whatever it is you're doing that would create less stress.
Now, what can we do as a general? I mean, there's a whole process and there's a whole course and stuff on how to, you know, what to do and stuff. But in general, just to kind of get ourselves to relax more, besides taking more breaks and walking around, what's like a starting point to kind of in general relax? Besides breathing slowly?
Well, we could talk about the general positions. Like, lots of times people really don't know how to relax.
And that's true.
Yeah, so we start with the basics. And you start by supporting the body as best you can. Now, I created that chair, and we're really not interested in pushing the chair tonight or at any time. It's a tool for people to see. But you could do a lot of that on your own. So when you're lying on the bed, you could start to add some supports to get yourself feeling even more comfortable than just lying on the bed. You know, how can you support your arms to get more relaxed? How could you support your knees and your legs and your feet? So I start with getting people in the supported positions initially, because when you're trying to have somebody relax when they're standing and sitting, it takes a long time. And when you're a little baby, it takes a long time it takes about a year to even stand up.
Right, right.
So we take all this for granted, and it's very complex. Standing on these small little places underneath our soles, there's not much support, and we have if we go too far forward, we're going to fall over, and we too far back. So we have all these things to consider. It's called proprioception, to perceive yourself in space. And so it's kind of a deep question you're asking. I'm hoping I'm answering.
Because that constant subtle movement when you're breathing, the deliberate and constant inhale, exhale, mm-hmm. all of that together with the motion of the body from the inhale, exhale, that instead of like a quick motion, as opposed to a slow in and out, mm-hmm. that constant gradual movement, I think is critical. I mean, I know for a fact, I was taught by people when I was taking acupuncture and stuff, that slow breathing is one way to, like if I had a cramp or something, mm-hmm. you panic and then you tighten up and the cramp gets worse. So what you had to do is you had to just breathe slow and even and consistent in and out, and it actually relaxes you. Mm-hmm. And it works. I mean, I didn't, until I tried it, and it actually, I could actually stop a cramp from spasming. And you had to stop and okay, easy in and out, mm-hmm. just take it easy, and you relax. And it's the same thing. I think it's that whole part of, you've got to learn that in terms of learning how to relax and stuff, that constant gradual movement. It's, you're constantly moving, very subtle. What I'm saying is, it's not like a, okay, I'm going to inhale and I move my hands like I'm, like expand my hands and expand, it's subtle. It's more like a, mm-hmm. I don't know how to describe that on radio.
Well, I wanted to cover, because I know the title of this program is Preventing Injuries. And so it seems like we're not really talking or discussing that, but we are. Mm-hmm. We really are. And so it would be nice to say, well, do these exercises and you're gonna live happily ever after. And there's more to life than doing exercise. It's really the what you do with your body all the time. And these are the things we're talking about. And to be aware, and most of these injuries, these tendinosis, tendinitis, and carpal tunnel can easily be remedied if we pay attention to this awareness and relax the tense areas, mm-hmm. balance out things, work with our postures. You'd be surprised how very easily we show people what they look like, and that's the best way to help them. Now, if they have the issues, we could get treatment for them, but once again, if you don't have the education with the treatment, you're just gonna continue to have the issues.
Right. Now, we're almost out of time, but I want to show some of the things, little tools you have to kind of like put yourself in a especially your hands, in a natural position. Mm-hmm. So I want you to explain these. I'm going to hand them to you and you can discuss them and show them on the camera.
All right. Well, this is like a half of a Nerf ball. And if you want to cut a Nerf ball in half, be real careful. And you want to make sure you draw a line around the center and then use a serrated edge knife. Easily do that. This is nice, and really what happens is the natural shape of the hand is shaped like a sphere. Mm-hmm. So when our bodies can feel that support, then you're going to distribute the stress and strain of the hands throughout the whole body. So this show, I mean, guitarists are dealing with their hands all the time. If you're going to relax, you're going to sit on a couch, watch some TV. If you have your hand on this support, mm-hmm. it's a way to just really relax the hand a little bit more rather than doing anything
else. It feels good. It follows the shape of the natural shape of your hand. And then here you have...
Yeah, the ball works, but this is actually even better. You get these little, small little footballs, and it can fit. If your hand is really, really big, you could have it closer to the point of it. Okay, and if it's small, if it's small, you have more to the point. If it's bigger, you can have it here. But this does a similar thing. This kind of allows you to put it on a flat surface. This, you'd have to have some kind of a pillow or something where you're positioning it where you're going to balance.
Actually, you can just like hold it in your lap or just on your chest or whatever if you're watching it's a very natural position to hold, I mean, for your hand.
Feels good.
It's very, yeah, if you just, and you know, don't squeeze it, just, you know, just put your hand on it, and that's the thing, don't apply pressure to it. And then you showed me this guy.
Yeah, I got different props here I brought. This is a big investment. It's about 50 cents. So I went to Home Depot, and I had one of those long dowels. You get them in different sizes, and I just cut it, and I have a little machine that rounds the edges. And this you could use to stretch your wrist out. And you could do all kinds of little tricks. And just for example, this is called the wrist wand, wristwand.com. It is about 20 bucks. So you could really save some money and just get one of these. And here, this is really an exercise, a little device and a prop that you could use for self-help, self-healing. Mm-hmm. So there's all kinds of, I brought some other things here. This I picked up actually today. These are kind of like, they're soft, and you could use them even if you're squeezing them, is for stress. But then you could also roll them like
the
balls. I have those balls, the ones that make the sounds. So using these balls also are very good for the hands and for the brain as well. So you can roll these different sized balls, are nice.
Well, we're out of time.
Unbelievable.
But again, you're just gonna have to come back again because there's way more to talk about. I'm glad that we got to video this so you can actually see. It's very important, and we'll post up the link for the video so you can see what he's talking about, because it's especially the posture in this little PVC pipe thing that he has under the guitar to help position it is you get a better idea what we're talking about, and I'll be posting pictures. His website is www.rocketshipwellness.com. And you do classes, you have seminars and...
Well, there's a section on there, if you go there, for musicians. So I actually have a pilot program for musicians where I'm helping musicians that are in need of care. And I'm working on a protocol to eventually have maybe a foundation where I can have a clinic set up where we can take care of these musicians that need some help.
Okay, and then we're going to leave with a piece of music that you wrote, because he is a guitar player. Dr. Allan is a guitar player. And just give me a quick, we'll take us out with this piece, but just explain a little bit about this piece.
Well, coming back into playing, I wanted to try to embody these principles that I'm discussing with you today. So I wanted a piece that would be easy. I've been working exclusively with the dad-gad tuning, because you don't need to do much to make a beautiful sound, and then you can just play. So you just play a few notes and you can sound really good. So I put this piece together recently. I call it Esperance, and Esperance means hope. Mm-hmm. And I think there's hope for myself to play guitar again in a more relaxed way, and I think there's hope for all of us to be better if we want to be.
Okay, I'm going to play this. This will take us out. Thank you again, Dr. Allan, for being on the show, and I look forward to having you on again. We will definitely do another show and explore this even more. Everybody, this is Esperance, and everybody have a great week, and check this out. This is that Taylor classical. I love the sound of this. Everybody have a good night.